स्वर्णा भगिनी हरिओम, यू कैन स्टार्ट योर सेल्फ म्यूटेड।
नमस्कार माँ।
नमस्कार।
पार्थाय प्रतिबोधिताम् भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथिताम् पुराण मुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीम् अम्ब त्वामनुसन्दधामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणीम्। नमोस्तु ते व्यासविशालबुद्धे फुल्लारविन्दायतपत्रनेत्र येन त्वया भारततैलपूर्णः प्रज्वालितो ज्ञानमयः प्रदीपः। प्रपन्न पारिजाताय स्तोत्रवेत्रैकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतदुहे नमः। सर्वोपनिषदो गावः दोग्धा गोपालनन्दनः पार्थो वत्सः सुधीर्भोक्ता दुग्धं गीतामृतं महत्। वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानन्दं कृष्णो वन्दे जगद्गुरुम्। भीष्मद्रोणतटाजयद्रथजला गान्धारनीलोत्पला शल्यग्राहवती कृपेण वहनी कर्णेन वेलाकुला अश्वत्थामविकर्णघोरमकरा दुर्योधनावर्तिनी सोत्तीर्णा खलु पाण्डवैरणनदी कैवर्तकः केशवः। पाराशर्यवचः सरोजममलम् गीतार्थगन्धोत्कटम् नानाख्यानककेसरम् हरिकथा सम्बोधनाबोधितम् लोके सज्जनषट्पदैरहरहः पेपीयमानं मुदा भूयाद्भारतपङ्कजं कलिमलप्रध्वंसिनः श्रेयसे। मूकं करोति वाचालं पङ्गुल्लङ्घयते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वन्दे परमानन्दमाधवम्। यं ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्ररुद्रमरुतः स्तुन्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदैः साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यं सामगाः ध्यानावस्थिततद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यै योगिनः। यस्यां तन्न विदुः सुरासुरगणाः देवाय तस्मै नमः। धन्यवादः।
धन्यवादः भगिनी। सदाशिवसमारम्भाम् शंकराचार्य मध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्ताम् वंदे गुरु परंपराम् ओम। परम वरिष्ठं ब्रह्मिष्ठं परमानंदरूपिणं परमार्थानंदयतिं सद्गुरुं प्रणतोऽस्म्यहम्। So Lord Krishna completed his main teaching actually with verse 20, pointing out that a person should gradually change his personality from tamoguna pradana to rajoguna guna pradana to sattvaguna pradana, and thereafter one has to come to jnana yoga or self inquiry, and through that he has to shift the identification from the ahankara I, which is subject to the three gunas, right? So he should shift the identification through the atma I, which is free, ever free from the three gunas. So thus from the teaching we came to know that every one of us has got a lower self called ahankara, which is endowed with three gunas, and a higher self called atma. So lower self, the ahankara, consists of body mind sense complex with borrowed sentiency called chidabhasa, and the higher self is the original consciousness, which is of the nature of satchit ananda. And the ahankara based life is going to be a sansari's life. Therefore the aim of spirituality is not to base our life on ahankara, but rather than the higher self, which is the atma, right? So ahankara based life is problematic because of two reasons. One is ahankara is always associated with karma, especially the prarabdha karma, and this prarabdha karma happens to be an invisible force, and this invisible force is going to constantly bring situations. Some may be favorable, many of them being unfavorable. Therefore ahankara's life is always that of a roller coaster, right? Unpredictable ups and downs, right? So we have seen, in fact, one fine day we are all right, then the next day we saw, in fact, in Chennai that on a Sunday morning suddenly the tsunami hit, and people who would have been walking on the beach for ages suddenly got swept away that particular Sunday, right? So anything can happen anytime because of the prarabdhas playing, and that is what impacts the ahankara, right? So ahankara is continuously confronting the invisible prarabdha karma. Here I would like to actually describe an example, which is a simile which Swamiji uses, and very very powerful one. Swamiji compares prarabdha to an unfair boxing match. Imagine there is a boxing match in which one boxer is visible to the other and the other boxer is invisible, right? I go on looking for him, right? I just get blows on the back, one on the heel, one on the right cheek, right? I turn that side and try to, you know, take care of that, and then the hitting happens on the other side. What an unfair boxing match this is, right? I know I can do something about it, but I don't know when the boxer hits, because that boxer is invisible and that invisible boxer can see me, right? Similarly, prarabdham is called adrishtam, and adrishtam is going to constantly attack. Adrishtam means not luck here, adrishtam, because in Tamil we use it for luck. Here adrishtam means something that is not seen and that can attack you. So prarabdham is called adrishtam here, right? So the ahankara is full of raga and dvesha also, in addition to this, right? So it is impossible for the ahankara to be free from raga dvesha or likes and dislikes, right? We saw indriyasthendriyasyarthe ragadvesho vyavasthito, right? So I am going to continuously judge situations, people, right? When situation is not according to my expectation, then I am upset, right? So continuous confrontation of unpredictable situations and continuous reactions in the form of anxiety, etc. This is what happens to the ahankara, right? So if you do not want to have such an experience, may you discover the other higher self and start invoking the higher self through what? A process called nididhyasanam, right? So as even the higher self becomes stronger and stronger in my mind, the ahankara becomes feebler and feebler. This actually you will experience as years of Gita and Vedanta start settling into our minds. It happens, right? Whatever we thought of as a very big thing starts appearing very small and with very less impact, right? So ahankara vasana, which reacts to the situation, right, that becomes weaker and weaker. Now shravanam and mananam can only introduce the lower self and the higher self, but shifting from the lower self to the higher self happens only through nididhyasanam, right? And then the aham atma asmi, that vasana becomes stronger, right? And the ahankara becomes a costume which I wear as per the role. And when from time to time, I retire to the green room and abide in my higher self, right? So different roles involve different dialogues. The actor will play the role. He will cry on the stage, laugh. But finally, when he always knows that in and through the beggar role or the crying role, he knows that his in reality he is somebody else, right? A rich person, right? So therefore converting that ahankara into a vesha, a costume, that is the spiritual journey, right? And which alone Swamiji presents as, how do you measure the progress? He says FIR reduction, that is frequency, intensity and recovery period after emotional disturbance or impact. And of course, triple C increase, which is confidence, calmness, right, and cheerfulness. So events will have to happen according to the law of the universe, which is in general, and law of karma, which is specific to the person. The general karma, which is universal, and a specific karma, which is personal. So the samashti prarabdha, right, and you have the vyashti prarabdha. Basically, the entire universe is a resultant of all the individual laws of karma put together, depending on, you know, or whether we have to suffer, right, with pollution levels, etc. All of us have had the same kind of karma fructifying in that aspect, right? So it is a combination of the general law of karma and the specific, right, law of karma. Now I said FIR reduction will happen and triple C increase will go up as I start abiding in my higher nature, right? And in the Bhagavad Gita itself, we saw matras parshastu kaunteya, right? We saw that whether it is heat or, you know, cold or whatever extremes are there, whether happiness, sadness, whatever it is, the jnani is always, his response to the situation is very uniform and thought through, right? So this is the way by which you can find out whether you are progressing in the spiritual journey. Am I assimilating the teaching or not? That is why Arjuna asks, how does a gunatita conduct himself? Can I find out who is a gunatita? Once we know the conduct of the gunatita, right, we can keep that model in mind, and instead of other things, we compare ourselves with the gunatita model, right? Never judging others, right? We should, all of this should be used only for self-assessment and introspection, not to check whether our neighbor or a family member is progressing, or is he having FIR reduction or not? No, right? It is only for self-assessment and introspection. Okay? So samatvam Krishna talked about in the 24th verse, which is what we were seeing in the last class. Samadukka sukaswastaha samaloshtashma kanchanaha tulya priya priyodhiraha tulya nindatma samsrutihi. Right? So in the previous shloka, Lord Krishna talked about the reduction of emotional disturbances by using this word na ingate, right? And Lord Krishna earlier used gurunapi dukkena, even when the event is so shocking to the world, it is not shocking to this jnani, right? He takes it with a balance, right? So swastaha here indicates the higher self or atma, right? Higher self or atma. And I am, if we have to remember the fourth capsule of the Vedanta, which is I am never affected by any event that happens in this material world or the material body mind sense complex. So I am unshaken from the standpoint of Atma the Chaitanyam, right? Swasmin swarupe gunatita atmani sthitaha means he abides. And what do we mean by abiding? Not, you know, suddenly sitting over the Atma or anything, right? It is mentally abiding in the higher nature, right? So only through Vedantic meditation or Nididhyasana this comes, right? So in the 13th chapter, Lord Krishna said, Vivikta Desha Sevitvam, go to seclusion from time to time, right? And then abide in your higher nature. I can become Brahmanishtaha and Swastaha. Here it is referred to as Swastaha, right? Therefore, Samadukka Sukaha, when Prarabdha brings favorable and unfavorable situations, he is able to withstand the impact and maintain the poise or balance. And Samaloshta Ashma Kanchanaha. In fact, I stopped here and somebody asked me to explain this also in the last class. Loshta means a clod of earth. And Asma means a stone and Kanchanaha means gold. So Samaha means he does not have strong attachment. One who is the same towards a clod of earth, a stone or gold. No strong likes or dislikes. So here that is the example that Krishna uses here, right? He has used several examples, heat, cold, right? Happy situations, unhappy situations. Here he is saying he is the same with respect to clay or stone or gold, right? So he, a strong like or strong dislike, he doesn't have the gunatitaha, right? So therefore a jnani practices diluting the likes and dislikes or ragadvesha by remembering that the emotional dependence is a risk, right? Therefore, right from Karma Yoga, he has practiced this during Nididhyasana. Also, he continuously dilutes the likes and dislikes, and even if he has them, is very important aspect, he makes them into a non-binding desire or preference. Swamiji gives such practical advices in this case. He says, even with your children, when they are grown up, right, after once they cross the teenage and, you know, they're becoming adults, always express whatever you would like them to do as a non-binding desire, at least at your mental level. It's a preference. If they choose to listen to you and implement, fine. If not, let go. Very, very difficult, but I think a very practical and useful advice here, right? So he says, convert binding ragadveshas to non-binding desires. In fact, the coffee in the morning also, it's very nice, and Shastra doesn't say you should not enjoy. But can we make it a preference instead of a binding desire, right? So I actually have faced this. When I have to go in the morning for a blood test without the cup of coffee, it is so difficult. Just to, you know, delay it till 9 o'clock, although that's maybe just the only cup that I have, but still it binds you, right? So if we can live without it for a few days, right, then it becomes a preference. You like to have it, but it doesn't cause any problem if you do not, one day you don't have access to it also, right? Very important point. So without that also, I can manage, right? So tayoho vasham na agachet, do not become a slave of ragadvesha, right? This jnani has practiced. So samaloshta ashma kanchanaha, means raga dvesha rahitaha, without likes and dislikes. Similarly, tulya priya priya dhiraha, priya priyo dhiraha. People also, the ones, the relatives, etc., loved ones, don't like ones, I don't like these people, right? So life involves interaction with both priya as well as apriya. And when such situations come also, it's fine, right? I can try to avoid, but if it is painful, let me go with it, right? Imagining the pain is still worse than actually facing the problem itself, right? Tulya priya apriyaha means he has a balance. Tulya means samaha. Tulya nindatma samstutihi. There will always be some people who will appreciate us, and there will be some people who will criticize us, whatever we do. Right? We cannot, there are some sayings, we cannot please everybody and everything in this world, right? World is full of different kinds of things, right? So we cannot always try to praise or criticize or receive criticism or praise from everybody. We cannot, you know, be responsible for how the others will be reacting to us, right? So it is better to accept both of them with the same equanimity, right? So even if you take Rama and Krishna avatara, so many people criticize both the avatars. So many people say they are the greatest people, right? So even when this is the case with Rama and Krishna, what about all of us, right? Dihi here means jnanam, and dhiraha means viveka jnanavan, which means a one with discriminatory mind, right? The jnanam he received is actually deep in the subconscious also, right? So this is the dhrida jnanam, right? Continuing. मानापमानयोस्तुल्यः मानापमानयोस्तुल्यः तुल्यो मित्रारिपक्षयोः तुल्यो मित्रारिपक्षयोः सर्वारम्भपरित्यागी सर्वारम्भपरित्यागी गुणातीतस्स उच्यते गुणातीतस्स उच्यते मान अपमानयोः. मानम मीन्स ऑनर, अपमानम मीन्स डिसऑनर इन टर्म्स ऑफ अदर्स बिहेवियर, राइट? समटाइम्स व्हेन आई गो टू समबडीज हाउस, सम रिलेटिव्स हाउस और फ्रेंड्स हाउस, आई एम रियली वेलकम, राइट? अनदर पर्सन मे थिंक, ओ माय गॉड, दिस पर्सन हैज कम एट द रॉन्ग टाइम, राइट? सो we may be welcome, we may not be welcome, we may get honor, we may not get honor, right? So even in old age, right, sometimes people may like us and people may do things for us, others may not feel that way, right? Even within our own children, grandchildren, etc., right? So jnani takes everything in the stride, and therefore mana apamana yoho tulyah. Previously, Ninda Stuti came in the shloka, right? The previous shloka. Mana Apamana is at the action or the treatment level, and Ninda Stuti is at the verbal level, right? Tulyo Mitra Aripakshayoho. Same between friends and enemies, right? Even though I don't want to think of anybody as an enemy, but you may have some people who are not very nice to you, but being the same without any raga and dvesha, right? That's the idea. I don't hate anybody. Sarvarambha parityagi. Arambha means all those actions which are done for the sake of purnatvam or fulfillment, right? They are called bandhaka karmani. Whatever karmas that I do, binding actions, right? Because I'm looking for purnatvam through karma, through karma phalam, right? It is a binding karma. Whereas in the case of jnani, he does not expect purnatvam from karma, because ahankara can never become purna by getting anything, right? Ahankara is finite, and finite can never become infinite. If I get 100 rupees, I want 1000. If I have 1000, I want a lakh, right? And if I have lakh, I want millions, right? So ahankara is ever apurnaha. Atma is Purnaha all the time. It can never get Purnaha by getting something. It is ever Purnaha, right? So, with fullness, once I abide in the Atma, with fullness I do the karma, contributing to the society, because my whole life is available for giving without expecting anything in return. Therefore, Sarvarambha Parityagi, the one who acts with fullness and never for fullness, right? The definition of samsari, right, is who? One who is constantly doing karmas for some karma phalam or not, seeking purnatvam, right? The definition of a liberated person is one who works with fullness. So samsari is one who works for fullness. A liberated person is one who works with fullness. So sarvarambha parityagi, giving up all binding actions. Arambha here means actions. Gunatitasa uchyate, right? So that's in short the triple C. The calmness, cheerfulness and confidence is the mindset of a gunatita. And through shravana manana nididhyasanam, our aim is to make our mind also closer to that of a gunatita. So in fact, in Shankaracharya's Bhashyam, Shankaracharya specifically says samatvam is not allowing objects, situations, people and the responses or behavior impact you. A jnani's life is like that, right? Continuing. Mam cha yo vyabhicharena, mam cha yo vyabhicharena, bhakti yogena sevate, bhakti yogena sevate, sagunan samatityaitan, sagunan samatityaitan, brahma bhuyaya kalpate, brahma bhuyaya kalpate. Of these three questions that Arjuna asked Lord Krishna, Krishna has answered two questions. He has talked about the lingam, the internal indicators to know whether I am progressing or not. Then he talked about acharaha, the external indicators to find out whether I am progressing or not. External indicators, decreased FIR and increased triple C. Now comes the third question, how to become a gunatita? Katam cha etan treen gunan ati vartate. In fact, Lord Krishna has already answered it in shlokas 19 and 20. The answer is through self-knowledge. Through jnanam alone, one can become gunatita. So, therefore, we have to rephrase the question slightly. Arjuna cannot ask how to become gunatita because already answer is given. The revised question should be how to get that jnanam, right? For which Lord Krishna gives the answer in this shloka. Yaha bhakti yogena sevate. The one who practices the scheme of sadhana called bhakti yoga, avyabhicharena, without distraction, without straying away, with sincerity and with commitment, avyabhicharena, unflinchingly, undistractedly, the one who worships me, sevate, bhakti yogena, by means of the sadhana, the scheme called bhakti yoga. Now what will happen? We will think, where did we see bhakti yoga, right? So if such a question is asked, what will be Lord Krishna's answer, right? In case Arjuna asked that question to Lord Krishna, oh, what do you mean by bhakti yoga, right? Then we saw it. We are now in the 14th chapter and we did 13th chapter, we did 12th chapter. And in the 12th chapter, I've actually given you the reference of the class also. We saw these 5 steps. If not anything else, I'm sure people will remember the colorful steps here. So we saw that there are 2 levels of karma yoga, 2 levels of upasana yoga and 1 level of jnana yoga. So the 5-step staircase called bhakti yoga of the 12th chapter, if a person practices, right, then slowly he will attain jnanam and he will become gunatita, right? So saha gunan samatitya, that person who practices bhakti yoga will transcend these three gunas and attain Brahma Bhuyaya, right? Brahma Bhavaha, Brahma Aikyam, oneness with Brahman, the all-pervading consciousness. And the answer is follow Bhakti Yoga. That's all. Become a Jnani. And by that way, you will become Gunatitaha. Right? Now comes the concluding shloka. So with this, actually the teaching part is over. Now the conclusion. Brahmano hi pratishtaham. Brahmano hi pratishtaham. Amrutasya vyayasya cha. Amrutasya vyayasya cha. Shashvatasya cha dharmasya. Shashvatasya cha dharmasya. Sukasyaikantikasya cha. Sukasyaikantikasya cha. So in the previous shloka, Lord Krishna said, the one who goes through Bhakti Yoga, the five-stepped Bhakti Yoga, becomes a Jnani, right? And he will become a Gunatita and he will attain Brahma Bhavam. So he's using a new word, Brahma, in this particular chapter here, right? And therefore, the question may come, what do you mean by Brahma? Lord Krishna answers and he says, when I say Brahman, it is none other than I myself. So I, Lord Krishna himself, is none other than Krishna Paramatma. That is not in his superficial form, basically his shariram, but in his real nature, he himself is Brahman. Therefore, he says, Ahameva Pratishta. The word Pratishta has different meanings. Okay. Commentators say, actually, for this particular verse, those of you who are interested, I am not going to get into the details. Commentators give, I think, about two or three meanings for Pratishta, and again, several meanings for Aham and several meanings for Brahman for this particular verse. Shankaracharya has actually struggled to give all these meanings and coherently put across different views, right? But here Swamiji stuck to only one explanation, and I am also going to stick only to that. But for those of you who are interested, can open the Bhashyam and read and see if you really want to understand. But I would say, unless you have done a lot of Shravanam Mananam, better to stick with whatever has been suggested and explained by Swamiji after going through all the various views expressed by Shankaracharya and of course Anandagiri and others. Okay. So, Aham Eva Pratishta, the word Pratishta, as I said, has different meanings. And here Pratishta means embodiment. I myself am the embodiment of Brahman in my real higher nature, because the body that I have taken by my Maya Shaktihi Sambhavami Atma Mayaya, right? This Krishna Shariram is a temporary costume, and behind the Krishna Shariram, I myself, the Brahman, is there. Aham Pratishta. I am the embodiment of this Brahman. So this Brahman happens to be here, Saguna Brahman, and Aham is the higher I. I am behind the Saguna Brahman or Saguna Ishvara, right? So Amritasya, it is immortal, and Avyayasya, inexhaustible or not subject to degeneration, Apakshayaha. So eternally the same immortal Brahman, I am the embodiment of that Brahman, and I am changeless, right? And I remain as it is, Ekantikasya Sukasya. That Brahman is the only source of Ananda. The worldly objects are seeming sources of Ananda, but they are all not the real ones. The real and only source of Ananda is Brahman, right? In the second capsule of Vedanta, we say, I am the only source, permanent source of peace, security and happiness. Therefore, Ekantikasya Sukasya means unconditional Ananda. I am the embodiment, and how is it attained? Shashvatasya cha. It prapya, and it can be attained through, which means through what? By claiming the higher I, that Brahman, which can be attained through Shashvatasya cha dharmasya, sanatana dharma, or through Vaidika marga, by following the basic path which has been condensed so far, Bhakti Yoga, and then going through the five stages, you can you can abide in the higher nature, right? You can attain Brahman that way, and you can attain permanent happiness at the mental level. You can enjoy eternal calmness. So with this, the 14th chapter of the Gita is over, right? Thus the 14th chapter is concluded, which is called what? Gunatraya Vibhagaha, the discrimination of the three gunas as well as the gunatita atma. Okay, we'll complete and then I will give you the summary quickly. Om Tat Sat, Om Tat Sat, Iti Srimad Bhagavad Gita Supanishadsu, Iti Srimad Bhagavad Gita Supanishadsu, Brahma Vidyayam Yoga Shastre, Brahma Vidyayam Yoga Shastre, Shri Krishna Arjuna Sambade, Shri Krishna Arjuna Sambade, Gunatraya Vibhaga Yogo Nama Chaturdashodhyayah, Gunatraya Vibhaga Yogo Nama Chaturdashodhyayah. So this portion started with a very, very brief introduction in the first four verses, right? So this is actually in the part of the Gita, which is 13th, 14th and 15th together. The three of them contemplate on Jnana Yoga Sadhana, which is the final sadhana for a spiritual seeker. Karma Yoga and Upasana Yoga are preparatory sadhanas, and we've seen them already. 13th chapter is very profound and significant, and the 14th chapter is built upon the discussion of the 13th chapter, and the 15th chapter is also going to continue this way. So Lord Krishna gave an introduction which reminded us about Purusha and Prakriti, the consciousness principle and matter principle, and these two principles together alone we call Ishvara. And of these two, Prakriti is endowed with three gunas and it is subject to change and division. Prakriti or matter is endowed with three gunas, right? And it is subject to change, attributes and division, right? And from this Prakriti Purusha mixture alone, everything has come up, right? And therefore, and Purusha is the one which is the higher nature of a person, and every individual living being has Purusha and Prakriti, right? So it is always easier to identify with the Prakriti part because it is the changing one and constantly reminds us. That's the body, mind, sense complex and the what the external world, everything. That is the Prakriti, right? And we also saw that Prakriti is Trigunatmika because it evolves from Trigunatmika Maya, Prakriti, right? And because of the Karanam, in the Karyam also, the Trigunas manifest, right? We saw all of this. So all the time, the Trigunas are present in different proportions in the Prakriti, and we are all a mixture of Purusha and Prakriti, right? Therefore, we should know that due to the three gunas, each one's characteristics will differ, and based on the time period in one's life, also how you change it using, say, Upasana, Karma Yoga, etc., the proportion of the Sattva, Raja and Tamo Guna keeps changing. So Lord Krishna gives this in the first four shlokas as an introduction, right? And then he went on to analysis of the gunas. If you remember, we saw this table, right? And from the fifth shloka up to the 18th verse, Lord Krishna makes a thorough analysis of the three gunas, what type of character change will be required for spiritual success. Then he discusses five topics: Lakshanam, the definition of each guna, right? Bandhana Prakaraha, how each guna can cause different types of bondage, right? And then Lingam, right? If you see here, so we saw Lakshanam first, then we saw Bandhana Prakara, right? and then the lingam or the indicatory mark to know which guna is dominant in us. Then we saw the phalam, right? That is the, what is the consequence of that, and then finally gati, what is the kind of travel which will be there after death, right? So the first one we saw was lakshanam, and the what is the definition? Lord Krishna says a very receptive, calm and very calm receptive state of mind indicates the domination of sattva guna. A restless and extrovert state of mind or an outgoing state of mind indicates rajoguna, and a dull or confused state of mind indicates the tamoguna, right? And how does each guna bind? We saw that also. A sattva guna makes the jnanendriyams to be more active, and therefore there is a greed or craving for more and more knowledge. Therefore, a sattvika mind is attached to an infrastructure which is conducive for more and more knowledge. And this very attachment becomes a bondage, because when this kind of an atmosphere is not there, even at home, then I feel very disturbed because I want to increase my knowledge. Therefore, I am attached to a knowledge-friendly infrastructure. Whereas when rajoguna is dominant, the mind is greedy for more and more action. It is not knowledge-centric mind. It is action-packed, right? So I want to do more and more action. My mind is that of a workaholic mind, right? So life will not always give you that kind of an infrastructure, and as we age older, it becomes a problem. So rajoguna dominant is a very, very active kind of lifestyle. And tamoguna wants an infrastructure where I can blissfully sleep all the time, or I'm more, you know, I have more of inertia or a little bit of sloppiness, right? So the tamasic mind is disturbed when it doesn't get an infrastructure like that. If somebody says, get up in the morning at 5 o'clock and do your puja or go for an exercise, that mind doesn't like, right? So we see that there is a cause of samsara because of being either sattvic or rajasic or tamasic, right? The third and fourth topic, if you see, indicate the indicators as well as the phalam, right? The phalam of sattva guna and the indication of sattva guna, both are same. And what is that? Lord Krishna says, jnana vriddhihi, right? Increase of knowledge is not only the consequence of sattva guna, it is basically the indicator also. You will know that a sattva guna person is, more, you can see that he exuberates more knowledge, right? So the indicator and consequence of rajoguna is karma vriddhihi, more and more karma. He'll be very active, running around, etc. And a tamoguna person, right, is nidra vriddhi, pramada vriddhi. Basically, is not very, you can see that he's very sloppy and slow, etc. And then Lord Krishna gave the fifth and final topic, which is the gati. Gati is after death, right? So Lord Krishna says, urdhvam gacchanti vrittastha adho gacchanti. Only inferior. Basically, he says, urdhvam gacchanti sattvastha madhye tishtanti rajasaha jaganya guna vrittastha adho gacchanti. We saw this in the 14th chapter itself. So when a sattvika person dies, because of the sattva guna, he goes to higher loka, and a rajasic person is neither higher loka nor lower loka. Horizontal, he's at the same level, right? If he's a manushya, he's a manushya, right? So it's only madhya loka, madhye tishtanti rajasaha jaganya guna vrittastha adho gacchanti. Only inferior janma, he will get the jaganya guna vrittastha. Because in this, right, in the tamoguna, the person was closer to an animal kind of mindset, right? And so thus all the five topics were covered between 5th and 18th verse. And then he gives a very important message, right? We should not miss that message, right? Because when we start getting involved in this, especially Gunatraya Vibhaga, we forget that our journey is beyond this, which is the Guna Titaha, right? A person can gradually change the composition of the three gunas in such a way that the life's journey becomes a grand spiritual journey utilizing the three gunas, one transcends the three gunas and becomes a gunatitaha. The aim of a tamasic person should be to become a little bit more active, gradually get to a rajasic kind of lifestyle by doing at least akama karmani, right? Praying for one's own family, etc. Then from a sattva guna, from a tamoguna kind of person to move to a rajoguna kind of a person, you sort of do more karma but with nishkama bhakti. Basically, don't ask for anything for yourself, right? So from sakama karmani to nishkama karmani, arthakama pradana to dharma pradana, you might even ask for jnana vairagya siddhyartham, right? And do lot of rituals and prayers, etc. Then from there to a sattva guna pradana lifestyle, right? And then finally you move from tamasa to rajasa to sattva and then to gunatita. Now as Swamiji puts it, we don't have to get worried about where we are, because it is a journey across multiple janmas. And if you are getting aware of the spiritual journey and understanding the what the shastras have to say, you would naturally be inclined to move from tamoguna to rajoguna to sattva guna. Little progress or whatever progress we can do in each janma, that will also only add to your or catapult you in the next janma, right? So this is the typical journey of a person who moves, a spiritual seeker's journey, which is gradual, right? So from no karma to sakama karma to nishkama karma to gunatitaha. Basically, doing nishkama karma, you develop more of sattva guna and then you become gunatitaha. Obviously, in along with this karma, upasana is also included. The mental refinement happens, which promotes sattva guna. We are able to, you know, understand the teaching better, absorb better, do better nididhyasanam, etc. Right? The ashramas are also suitable for that. Slowly from brahmacharya ashram to grihastha ashrama, where we do a lot of rituals, to vanaprastha ashrama, where we have more contemplation, upasana yoga pradana, and then to sannyasa ashrama. Right? And as Swamiji says, internal sannyasa is more important than an external sannyasa or taking to a kashaya vastra and being in an ashrama. You can be in an ashrama but still not have a lot of binding desires. The desire may be different, right? With respect to, as Swamiji puts it, a Rudraksha mala or the kutiya, the small kutiya, right? But the binding desires are still the binding desire. So it is the mental state which is more important than actually the ashrama. Internal sannyasa is very important, right? As you progress through jnana yoga. Then the 19th and 20th verse, which we completed in the last class, is knowledge as the means to transcend the gunas, right? So what is this jnana yoga, right? So we did see prakriti, purusha, ahankara, right? The body, mind, sense complex, etc., right? And how is atma different from this? What is it that is making the body, mind, sense organ, sense complex sentient, right? And Vedanta calls this part, the body, mind, sense organ, which is blessed by Chidabhasa, as ahankara. And Vedanta says, as long as you claim the ahankara as I, the life is going to be miserable, because ahankara is limited in resources and it is under the influence of powerful prarabdha, right? Not only the world, including time and space, affects the ahankara, right? By giving old age, disease, death, etc., ahankara is also affected by prarabdha karma, right? So, and when with human janma itself, I am feeling so helpless at times, where I have a free will and I can influence, what happens when I'm born as a cow or a monkey or a donkey or, you know, a hen or a goat, right? So, you know, you never even know what kind of death you will have and how these animals, some of the animals are really treated very badly, right? So we have to understand that it is only in manushya janma that we can even try and influence what we can do and achieve, right? So if you want moksha, learn to claim your higher I, right? Ahankara is the lower I or the pseudo I, and so he uses the word reduce the ahankara into a vesha or costume, right? So in jnana yoga, first step is to attend classes, basically Gita, Upanishads, etc., in a systematic and consistent way. Even if you are spending 1 hour per week, it should be regular and you should have time for revision. Or if you are going to increase it, you can take up 2 texts, etc. But that regular, consistent and systematic study of the scriptures, preferably under a jnana nishtha guru, right? Especially when it comes to Upanishads and all, very important, right? So who has come the traditional way, right? A traditional acharya, right? So that is the kind of teacher with whom you undergo this jnana yoga journey, right? Shravanam, mananam and nididhyasanam, right? Gita gives that jnana. Definitely it is a beginner's study, right? So for a qualified student, Bhagavad Gita itself can give jnanam and moksha. For a non-qualified student also it is okay, because that shravanam adds to punyam. Gita shravanam, understanding the meaning, adds to punyam, and this punyam will take you gradually to the on the spiritual path, right? So my higher and real nature, which is called purushaha here, chaitanya tattvam, right? So in chapter 7, in fact, we saw detailed description: satyah, nityah, karta, bhokta, sarvagatah, nirvikarah, atma, etc. Here it is just more a revisiting and revising. Krishna wants to remind Arjuna. So the primary purpose of the human body is to know my higher nature. The fourth purushartha, the moksha purushartha, is the primary objective of the human life, right? And having understood aham purushaha, I have to dwell upon it, which is called nididhyasana. And as I dwell more and more upon atma, the ahankara and the mamakara. Ahankara is I, body, mind, sense complex. Mamakara is my family, my possessions, my profession, etc., right? So these are the two things, ahankara and mamakara, and resulting in strong raga and dvesha. This is very worth remembering. This is called dushta chatushtayam, the four dushtas, right? Ahankara, mamakara, raga, dvesha, right? These four are referred to as dushta chatushtayam, and our journey is first diluting the dushta chatushtayam, right? So very important. So thus nididhyasanam makes a person gradually jnana nishtha or atma nishtha, and he is able to abide in the higher nature, right? So, and that is what he said in these two shlokas, right? The essence of jnana yoga in simple language is what? Shifting the I from ahankara to atma, prakriti to purusha. That is the essence of jnana yoga, which is what is highlighted here, right? So Arjuna became very curious to know about a person who has successfully gone through this when Krishna spoke about all this. And then he asked the questions: what is the lifestyle of a gunatita purushaha, right? And what is the lingam, the indicator? How do I know? How does he become a gunatitaha, etc.? Lord Krishna has answered that question in the subsequent verses, actually, from 23-24 onwards till 27, which we actually saw today, right? So gunatita lakshanam and sadhanam is what we saw. Most part of it we completed today from verses 21-27, right? So constantly being dissatisfied and complaining about the mind is one form of samsara, because mind can be our worst enemy. So tackling the mind and making it sattva pradana mind, and ultimately transcending it, transcending the gunas, is the journey of the jnani itself, right? So this is what we saw today. So I am not getting into the details of what we saw today, and that is what is summarized in the fourth topic. Basically is gunatita lakshanam and sadhanam, right? And what is bhakti yoga? We saw that in the 12th chapter, which is the five-stepped bhakti yoga, which is karma yoga 1, karma yoga 2, and then we saw the basically the sakama pradana karma yoga, nishkama pradana upasana yoga also we saw. So we saw karma yoga 1, karma yoga 2, then we saw upasana yoga 1, which is ekarupa ishvara dhyanam. Upasana yoga 2 is vishwarupa ishvara dhyanam. So sakama karma yoga, nishkama karma yoga, ekarupa ishvara dhyanam upasanam or ishta devata upasanam, to vishwarupa ishvara dhyanam, which will dilute the dushta chatushtayam. Ahankara, mamakara, ragadvesha will get diluted by vishwarupa ishvara dhyanam. What do we mean by vishwarupa ishvara dhyanam? Just looking at the nature, the sky, etc., and seeing that as the Lord, right? Exactly how Arjuna saw Vishwarupa Ishvara, right? Then the fifth step of Bhakti Yoga is Jnana Yoga in the form of Shravanam, Mananam and Nididhyasana. And then I claim that I am actually the Atma having a temporary body, right? And by remembering this, I can enjoy life as an entertainment, right? And I am the immortal Atma. Claiming this is the success of Jnana Yoga, and Arjuna, may you follow that if you are interested in moksha. With this, the 14th chapter is over, and it is titled Gunatraya Vibhaga Yoga because it analyzes the three gunas and the gunatita atma as distinct from the three gunas. Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Let me see if there are any hands raised. Any questions? Any of you? So the next chapter will be the 15th chapter called Purushottama Yoga, which I will start in the next class. Okay, there are some questions here. How one can remain totally unaffected by the happenings around us? Yeah, this is exactly the journey. We are made of flesh and blood, emotion filled, yes. But you would see that as you go through this journey, definitely you will see this FIR reduction happening. And slowly we are able to see that there are some great people who are able to transcend these gunas to a large extent, and you will not see turbulent behavior when there are catastrophes or disasters. In fact, Swamiji always makes this, he differentiates between love and attachment, right? He says, people think that worrying for the children means love. He says, no, that is attachment. Love means unconditional. You do your best, but you don't get worried. So that's a kind of, it takes a long time, you know, of meditation, karma yoga, which is dispassionate, that is nishkama karma yoga, etc., to get there. But in this journey, each one can make a self-assessment and you will definitely find a progress as you go on this journey. 14:25 verse. Is it all right to pursue hobbies such as gardening? It does require a lot of action. See, there is nothing wrong in pursuing any action or anything, right? You can continue that. even after transcending all the gunas, if you take the example of Janaka, right, King Janaka in Ashtavakra Gita, there is so much spoken about him, and you can be an akarta abhokta even while doing things. You must remember karmanyevadikaraste. Basically, you are doing it, enjoying the action itself without having a binding desire for the result, saying the result has to be this way or that way. That is what is meant here. You can be involved in actions, right? But if you want to make sure that you have mental refinement, then you have to go through religious karmas, right? Panchamahayagna, without any binding desire, even in the Panchamahayagna. And if you're asking for things because you want something for your children, family, that is Sakama Bhakti. With Nishkama Bhakti, doing Panchamahayagna will slowly refine the mind, right? So I hope I'm clarifying here. In verse 26, he who worships me, he is Ishvara, Brahman or Krishna. This is actually verse 27. I am not going to get into the details of what Shankaracharya has said. So whatever I have, I think you got the answer in verse 27. So whatever I have said is what Swamiji has finally communicated. And I think it's a very nice explanation, saying Aham Krishna is saying I the higher self, Brahman, is actually the pratishta of the Saguna Brahman or Ishvara, right? So irrespective of guna status, can people aspire and work for moksha? Yes, absolutely. You just go through the 5-step path that has been shown by Krishna himself in the earlier chapter. He says bhakti yoga is a way. You will finally become a jnani bhakta. We also saw artha bhakti, artha bhakti, jignyasu bhakti and jnani bhakti. Ultimately, you go through this path, God will show you the path and slowly you will get there, right? So, can you please review prakriti? One second, there's one more question here. Can a predominantly tamasa guna person work for gunatita? I think I mentioned this in the last class. Honestly, a tamasa person cannot become gunatita unless there is a miracle, which is again happening through prarabdha karma. Otherwise, it is a gradual journey. A tamasa person can only first start, you know, some religious rituals. Only then, first let him start some sakama. Let him pray for his family, well-being, etc. That is the first step. It's very, very rare that a tamasa guna person will directly become a gunatita unless something is sleeping in his vasanas, and due to that prarabdha maturing at that time, some spark happens. But no, in general, let's not look at exceptions. Generally, it has to be a gradual journey. Can you please review prakriti again? You had mentioned in the earlier classes, it is not the prakriti we know. Yeah. Don't worry about this, because prakriti will be reiterated again and again. Even in the 15th chapter, this subject is going to be revisited again. So I will make sure that I revise again at that time. Yeah, three C's. FIR and three C's. Even in introduction to Vedanta, these acronyms are there. I'm very grateful to Swamiji for having presented this. This is a way by which you know whether you are progressing on the spiritual journey. FIR, I explained frequency, intensity and recovery period after a emotional disturbance or emotional impact. 3C is calmness, cheerfulness and confidence. These three will go up simultaneously when the FIR reduction is happening. So you know that you are progressing on the spiritual journey. So this is an indicator for that, which you can check yourself. And I was telling that we should never use it for judging others. It is a self-assessment too. Anybody else wants to speak up? I think I've answered all the questions. Very interesting questions here. So I think there are no more questions. Okay. So we will meet next week, same time. Hari Om.